Hello, Emmanuel, Light of the World. I am Pastor Rakia Wright, and I am so grateful and so thankful for you all being here with me this evening for our Believers Night. We decided to do Believers Night here on our YouTube page tonight. We spent an entire month in the sanctuary face-to-face doing an incredible series on 1 John. And so right now we are entering into something that I think is going to be a great companion to where we just spent the last 7 or 8 weeks going through 1 John. You know, I just believe that, you know, as we are discovering and learning how to truly live an authentic Christian life, that's what the letter of 1 John was really gleaning and shining light on, having us to see, you know, and test and give evidence that that we truly belong to God, right? And have that assurance and security in our eternal life and in our relationship with him. So I hope you guys enjoyed this last 8 weeks going through the letter of 1 John. And so what I want to really focus in on, I know you guys saw the title of tonight's message or series that we're going to be delving into for the entirety of November. And I'm so excited about it. You know, sometimes we can read a series or read a title of something and think, I'm getting offended by the title. And the title is Overcoming Offense. But don't let this series and this title of this series bring offense to you, because, you know, it's my job as a pastor to make sure that we are teaching holistically, we are teaching and shining light and walking us through the text, through the Bible, and help us to really live overcoming lives. And so this series is for me, as just as much as it is for you, for me. And so, you know, what I realized in my years of living, that there's no getting around this subject of offense. I was just offended last week. And I know that you guys know what it feels like to be offended. I mean, it is something that if we allow it, it is something that we could deal with every breathing day on the face of this earth. And so what I realize is that it's really a trap of the enemy. And so I'm so excited because this series is really going to help us to really live an overcoming life, but also live a life that is unoffendable. Can somebody put that in the chat box this evening? That it is possible to live an unoffendable life. And we're going to help you walk through that. I'm going to help myself walk through that in this series. So buckle up, get your Bibles, get your journals. I mean, we need to write down some things, some scriptures. And these are some things that I want you guys to study throughout the week and really allow this message to get embedded into your heart. Amen. So as before we go into this, let's go ahead and open up with a word of prayer and then we'll dive right in. Father God, we just thank you for this day, God, that you have given to us. We're so grateful for an opportunity to be able to sit at your table. God, I don't take it lightly. We don't take it lightly, God. We thought enough of this message. We thought enough of what you are wanting to feed us today, Lord God, to make time in our schedule, to make time in our day, Lord God, to receive and to eat and to grow. So Father God, we ask that you would meet us here. Holy Spirit, we ask that you would minister to each and every person, Lord God, who is tuning in to this message tonight. Father God, allow this message, Lord God, to work within us, Lord God, and to produce in us, Lord God, the fruit that you desire to be produced in us, Father. We yield to your spirit. Father, we open our hearts to be receptive to your word today. In Jesus Christ's name, amen. 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 All right, let's get into it. Now, I want to share and I want to say this, that this message is inspired by a book that John Bervere wrote. If for those of you who are not familiar with John Bervere, Google him. He's a wonderful man of God, wonderful preacher. He pours a lot into not just his people, his members and things of that nature, but he pours into leaders and pastors and things of that nature. But he wrote a book called The Bait of Satan. And so we're going to get some of his notes and his information from that book. And so if you want to dive deeper in this subject, then I want you to go to Amazon. And this is just a plug, and purchase that book, Bait of Satan by John Bervere. All right, so just a little information about where we're going in the month of November with this series that we're doing. I believe this is important because I believe that offense is something that everybody deals with. Everybody, myself included. And I shared with you guys earlier that I was just offended last week. And so this is something that we are tempted by and tempted with and can be tempted with daily, right? On our jobs, in our marriages, with our children, with a person who is trying to get in front of you on the road, you get offended with them because they didn't put their blinker on. I mean, offense can be, even in the church, offense can be everywhere. And so my hope, you know, I like to present this at the beginning of a series of what my hope is when this is all said and done. My hope is that this series will give us an opportunity to grow together, that this series will give us an opportunity to mature and to grow in our relationships with one another, with our spouses, with our children, with our neighbor, you know, with our pastors, with our, you know, church family, you know, that we would have an opportunity to grow and to mature in our relationships. Oh, let me add coworkers and bosses, right? Because we can get offended by them as well. So, you know, this is also an opportunity to really remove every hidden wall, because offenses create walls in our lives. It creates walls in our hearts. And so this series, as we are receiving these messages, this message, you know, tonight, and even the messages in the upcoming weeks, that it would remove the hidden walls and the hidden barriers in our relationship. You know, because sometimes we can think that we're over something or we're not offended by something, but really there's a wall and there's still a barrier there, right? So, you know, my prayer is that this series would give us an opportunity to recognize and to overcome, you know, really just strategies of the devil, the strategies of the enemy. Because how many of y'all know that he is strategizing against us? He's strategizing against you. He's strategizing against your marriage. He's strategizing against your coworkers. He's strategizing in the church. And so we want to make sure that we are in a place where we can recognize and overcome the strategies of the enemy. I want to read a scripture and turn with me. I'm going to pull up my phone, but turn with me to Luke chapter 17. Verse 1, Luke chapter 17, verse 1. And I'm going to read from the KJV version, a version that I really don't preach from, but I love how it's worded, okay? So it says here in Luke chapter 17, verse 1, "Then said he unto his disciples, it is impossible, but that offenses will come." "But woe unto him through whom they come." Amen. So what he's saying here is that it's impossible, right, that no offenses should come. So that's telling us that offenses will come. They will come when you least expect it. They will come, you know, through anybody. They will come through close people. They will come from people that you don't know, right? But they're bound to come. It's impossible for you to go throughout life and not be offended or have an opportunity to be offended. It's impossible for you to go through life and not offend people. My driving offends some people on the road, strangers that I don't know, right? Because maybe I forgot to put on my blinker and I got over in front of them and now they're shooting me birds and they're cussing me out, right? And so offended, right? Now offense can come and it can be intentional, it can be unintentional, but I want us to realize and understand that you are not alone. If you have found yourself offended, if you are in offense right now, you are not alone. And offenses will come, all right? So Jesus is really, in this chapter, he's warning his disciples. He is warning his disciples of one of the most major strategies of the devil. One of the major strategies of the devil is offense. One of the most major strategies of the devil is offense. And what Jesus is telling his disciples in this book, he's saying, offenses will come. When we send you out, when you go forth, especially in my name, when you go forth, offenses will come. And one of the dangers that he wanted them to know is that offenses will not just come, but offenses will literally divide relationships. Offenses will divide family. Offenses will divide marriages. Offenses will divide a church. Amen? And so what he's wanting the disciples even to know, and what he wants us to know even tonight, is that offenses has the ability to really imprison us. It has the ability to hold people in bondage. I know what it feels like to be held in bondage by an offense, right? To that spirit of offense. I know what it feels like to be in a bondage situation, in prison by offenses. And so Jesus warns his disciples, listen, guys, as you go out, this is one of the strategies and one of the snares and one of the baits of Satan. And he says, I need you to guard your heart. I need you to guard your personal relationships. Amen. And so let's look at this particular point. Offense is a bait of a trap. It is a bait of a trap, right? And remember, we're gleaning some of this information from John Bervere's book, Bait of Satan. So offense is the bait of a trap. Amen. We all know what it is. Maybe we don't know, but most of us may know, you know, you put out a bait in order to get, you know, someone to step into your trap so that you can do whatever it is that you want to do with it. Maybe it's a mouse that you're trying to catch. What is the bait that you put into that trap? You put cheese, right? Or the smell of cheese. And that mouse comes to that cheese. He's trapped in the bait, right? He's trapped because of the bait and he's unable to escape. And that's how some of us may have experienced certain offenses, right? And certain baits that we have taken by people, by relationships, by experiences that we have fallen into, and it has left us in prison or trapped. All right. So the word offense in the Greek, it's, and I'm going to probably butcher this name, but it's skandalein, and I'm going to spell it for us. S-K-A-N-D-A-L-O-N. And basically what that means, it's a trap stick used in a trap. So like I mentioned before, when you're trying to catch a mouse, you put cheese, right? It is the stick. It is the bait that literally entraps the mouse. Okay. So the animal will see the bait, right? But he does not see the snare. He doesn't see that this, if he goes after the cheese, that this contraption is going to snap hold to his tail and he's not going to be able to escape. Think about those relationships that you have in those situations that were so tempting, right? Because of their attitude or because of what they said or what they did, you know, or how they responded or whatever it is, that was really a bait. And enemy's like, yes, I want her to grab hold to this bait so that I can trap her and imprison her with this spirit of offense, where she cannot break free, where she cannot, you know, move from this place of offense. Amen. Are y'all seeing this today? So once that animal sees the bait, right? The trap is closed. There's no escaping, right? It's a done deal, right? It's over, right, for that animal. And so, you know, let's look at 2 Timothy. I'm going to read this other scripture really quickly. Let's look at 2 Timothy, and we're going to look at chapter 2. 2 Timothy chapter 2 and verse 24 through 26. And again, I'm reading from the King James Version, but it says, "But foolish and unlearned questions avoid, knowing that they do gender strifes. And the servant of the Lord must not strive, but be gentle unto all men, apt to teach, and patient, in meekness, instructing those that oppose themselves. If God peradventure you will give them repentance to the acknowledging of the truth, and that they may recover themselves out of the snare of the devil, who are taken captive by him at his will." Amen. So they that may escape the snare of the devil. All right. So we can escape the snare of the devil. Amen. Some people are captured. Some people are captured by the devil, right? At his will. And maybe you found yourself captured by the enemy in this way, by at his will. All right. So to capture means to capture alive, to make a prisoner of war. So you're not dead, but you're captured alive. That mouse is captured alive, right? As he takes hold to that bait. So, you know, what I realize is that people don't always realize what has happened to them. That mouse that has been trapped in that bait, he's looking around. He doesn't really realize that, hey, I've been captured. He's so busy eating the cheese. He's unaware of what has really happened to them. You know, I'm unaware when I found myself in a place of offense and entangled by this trap, I'm unaware of what has really happened. All I can see is the issue and the problem, right? The bait, you know, and I justify, you know, even how I'm feeling because of what I've experienced. And so we don't even realize sometimes that we've been captured, right? And so for me, that's really a spirit of deception, right? The enemy deceiving us in these moments of entrapment, in these moments of temptation. You know, people who are offended, they don't realize that they're really opposing themselves. You know, we think that we're opposing the other person. We think that we are, opposing the person who has done the damage or the person who has done the offense, but we're really opposing ourselves. Okay. So we have to recover our senses. We have to recover our senses and become sober again. And so that's why I'm so excited about this message this entire month, because this message should be a sobering message. It should be a message that is sobering up our senses to begin to open up our eyes to what the enemy really is doing, right? What the enemy really is trying to, make happen in our lives. Amen. So the point that I want us to get from this first area that we're focusing in on is that offenses are bait. Offenses are bait, and they have the ability to draw people into a trap that they do not see. I want y'all to think about the last time you were offended, right? And how easily it was to get into that trap, right? But it has a drawing effect on you that you do not see, and it has the ability to hinder the relationships in your life, and it has the ability to be productive in your life. Amen? So the question that I want us to ponder on right now in this moment is this: are you offended? Just take a moment. If you want to write the question down, I want you to write the question down. Are you offended? Amen. And the second question that I want you to write down is this: how would you know if you were? How would you know if you were? Amen. All right. So I want us to, you know, we're going to go a little bit further and a little bit deeper right now, but I want us to begin to look at tonight is how offenses destroy relationships. How offenses destroy relationships. Amen. All right. So let's look at Matthew 24 and 10. Go ahead and pull that up. Matthew 24 and 10. And it says here, and again, I'm still reading from the King James Version, Matthew 24 and 10. And it says, "And then shall many be offended and shall betray one another and shall hate one another. And then shall many be offended and shall betray one another and shall hate one another." What I want us to really glean in on this scripture is the progression of what the enemy is doing in our lives. The progression, right? It starts with the offense, and then it moves to the betrayal, and then it moves to hatred. Amen? So there's a progression in what the enemy has strategized against us that we've taken the bait to, right? And this is the progression. So I'm going to break down all three of these, and I want y'all to write notes on all three of these that the scripture shows us this progression of this bait that the enemy gives. I want us to look at Proverbs 18 and 19 really quickly, 18 and 19. And I'm going to read the paraphrase version, but it says, "A brother offended is harder to be won than a stony city." A brother offended is harder to be won than a stony city. I'm going to read it one more time. A brother offended is harder to be won than a stony city. I want to just sit right there for just a moment, because when you think about relationships or you think about moments and times in your own personal, you know, life, or maybe times when you were offended, you know, or maybe you offended someone else, and maybe you were trying to win them over, right? And how difficult it was, because a brother offended is harder to be won than a stony city. Amen. I want us to paint a picture of just the Old Testament cities during this time. The Old Testament cities, if you can just imagine for just a moment, they were cities that were built up where there were walls literally surrounding the entire city to protect them from their enemies. You know, so there were these tall walls that were built up around the city to protect them. And these walls controlled who was coming into the city and who was going out of the city. So, you know, these walls were their protector, and they were the guard surrounding the city, right? Who could come in, who could come out. And so when he's relating offenses and how to a wall, or offenses to a stony city, offenses will literally build walls around your heart. And I know many of us have heard that before, but that's exactly what it's doing. As we find ourselves in places of offense, what it's doing is it's building walls around our heart that is preventing people from coming in and preventing people from preventing you from coming out and flowing out, right? And so, and the reason why is the same reason that these cities had these walls around it, to protect them from their enemy. When someone has offended you, in your mind, you're saying, this person is my enemy, and I don't necessarily want to be hurt by them again. And so I'm going to build this wall of offense around my city, around me, so that I can prevent myself from being hurt again. Listen, I've done it. I've walked through it. Amen. And I pray that I'm not the only one holding my hand up. Amen. This is so true. This is so real. Walls have the ability to deny people who we fear will hurt us from getting in again. Amen. And what happens is it will require them to pay a debt to us. But sometimes that person may not know that they've offended you. And they may know that they've offended you. You know, but if the requirement to get through the wall is a debt needing to be paid, amen, that's a clear sign that there is a wall there, right? That I'm not going to let down until that debt is paid. Amen. So with that wall there, nothing can come in, really. And nothing can flow out. That means you can't flow out. Amen? Because the goal here now, with the walls being put up, the goal here now is to protect myself. And you guys, I know firsthand what that is. I know firsthand what that feels like. I want to protect myself. Let's look at 2 Corinthians 10 and 4. I hope y'all are seeing this today, 2 Corinthians 10 and 4. You know, I don't want to be the only one that's breaking through, right, and living an unoffendable life. How many of y'all know that it is possible to live an unoffendable life? It's possible. Amen? The temptation of offense will always be there, but it is possible to go through moments and times of your life unoffendable. Amen? All right, so let's look at 2 Corinthians 10, 4 through 6. It says, for the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down, what's the first one? Strongholds. Amen? I'm going to stop right here. A stronghold, remember, we're talking about a city. We're talking about walls that are being built. A stronghold literally is a fortified, defended position that will hinder access at all costs, right? A stronghold, right? So he says, our weapon of warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God for the pulling down of strongholds. The next part in verse 5, it says, casting down imaginations. Imaginations is reasoning. Your ability to reason, right? Because that mind is going and going and going. And sometimes the enemy will even play on those reasonings. He'll play on that imagination, right? He'll begin to play on your mind and on your thinking. But he says here that the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God for the pulling down of strongholds and casting down imaginations. And verse 5 continues, every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God. Every high thing. What are those high things? Pride is a high thing. Self-centeredness is a high thing. Focused on just preserving yourself, protecting yourself. That is a high thing, right? He says every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God. Amen? So offenses create reasoning and barriers to knowing and walking in God. Amen? Let's look at 1 John, because we just ended the series with 1 John. And this is why I'm coupling this series with the series that we just finished in 1 John, because it's so needed. Amen. In order for us to walk out and carry out 1 John, we need to overcome offenses. Amen. So 1 John 4:8, it says this, and I hope y'all are writing these scriptures down, but it says, he that loveth not knoweth not God, for God is love. He that loves not does not know God. Amen. So let me ask you this question, because I want us to really think through. I hope y'all are writing these questions down and take them to God in prayer. Who are the people who offended you? Write them down. As I'm speaking about this message, who is Holy Spirit bringing to your mind? Write those names down. Amen. Write them down. Amen. Even the people who, and I just hear this in the spirit, even the people who might be dead and gone, even the people who you have not seen in years, but if you see them, oh, if you see them, amen, that wall goes right back up. Got to protect myself. Just because they're out of sight, it does not mean that you have healed or you have let it go. Amen. So write those names down. Ask Holy Spirit. Amen. Luke 21:16. Let's look at this real quick. Luke 21:16. Luke 21:16. And we're almost done. Luke 21:16. I hope y'all are getting something tonight. It says, and ye shall be betrayed both by parents and brethren and kinsfolk and friends. And some of you shall they cause to be put to death. Amen. He says, and you shall be betrayed by parents, by what? Brothers, by sisters, by relatives, by friends. Amen. What he was saying was the people closest to you, the ones that you have relationship with. Say, ouch. Ouch. Amen. But the question tonight for us is why? And I want to tell you, the reason why we are offended or feel betrayed by those closest to us is because we expect more. We become offended when we expect more and our expectations are not met. You expected more from your husband. You expected more from your wife. You expected more from your child. You expected more from your coworker. You expected more from your boss. You expected more from your neighbor. You expected more from your cousin. You expected more from your friends. You expected more from your pastors. You expected more. So once we're offended and the walls are built and it's not dealt with, the progression is now betrayal. What is betrayal? Betrayal is to, by definition, it's to disclose secrets. It's to treat people with treachery. It's to violate relationship. It's to violate loyalty and allegiance. It's to surrender. It's to give up. It's to put into prison. Ma'am? You know, one thing that I realized about close relationships, close personal relationships, they result in a level of intimacy. They result in a level of vulnerability. Amen. And even trustworthiness. Amen. When it comes to relationships, when it comes to intimacy, Amen. In the New Testament church, they had what we would call like a covenant community. And we hear that word all throughout scripture, covenant. We hear that throughout the Bible, Old Testament, even New Testament. We're under, you know, new covenant, right? But that word covenant is really what the Lord intended for us to have between two people, right? Those who are in a committed relationship. Amen. Like a husband and a wife, we have a covenant. We're in a committed relationship. But even those who are in the body of Christ, in the local body, there is an agreement in relationship between people. Amen. So whenever the covenant is broken, it's reflective of the betrayal in the relationship. Amen. So that word betrayal is simply to abandon the relationship, really to protect yourself. Remember, that wall is up. I don't want to be hurt. I don't want to be hindered. I don't want to be in that same position. And so maybe your betrayal may look very different. Some betrayals may, you know, people may lose loyalty, allegiance, or just give up, walk away, you know, put them into some sort of prison. But betrayal is betrayal. Amen. And I want us to look at some ways that we see betrayal in the scripture. Very quickly, let's look at John chapter 12. Let me pull it up. John chapter 12. And we're going to look at let's look at verse 4, and then we're going to move to chapter 13. Let's look at verse 4. It says, "Then saith one of his disciples, Judas Iscariot, Simon's son, which should betray him." Amen. Let's look at chapter 13 of that same book, verse 27. And it says, "And after the sop, Satan entered into him. Then said Jesus unto him, that thou doest, do quickly." So Jesus knew that he was going to betray him. He said, "Whatever you're doing, just do it quickly." Amen. So Judas was offended. Amen. And his offense equated to betrayal. Amen. He revealed Jesus's whereabouts. Amen. Then we see in Matthew 26 and 31, let's go there quickly. Matthew 26 and 31. 26 and 31. Let me see. It says, "Then saith Jesus unto them, all ye shall be offended because of me this night. For it is written," this is Jesus speaking, he said, y'all gonna be offended because of me. Wow. "For it is written, I will smite the shepherd, and the sheep of the flock shall be scattered abroad. But after I am risen again, I will go before you unto Galilee." Amen. So the disciples were offended. Jesus said, "You're gonna be offended because of me." So the disciples were offended, and as a result, it led to betrayal. And how so? They abandoned Jesus. They left him. Amen. I want to read this last one in 2 Samuel 15. Well, I'm not going to read. I want you to write it down because there's a lot in that talking about Absalom. But anyways, Absalom was offended. And because he was offended, it led to his betrayal. And he ran down David. Amen. And so we see the progression. You're offended. Then it goes to some form of betrayal. Amen. And then the last one, we're going to end on this. It leads to hatred. Hatred. You say, "I don't hate anybody. I'm a Christian. I don't hate anybody." But let me define hate. Amen. So hate is really strong feelings of anger, strong feelings of rage, strong feelings of hostility. Amen. So if we've had any of those expressions or feelings towards an individual, not just their sin, because we're going to talk about that too, you know, because you can be angry with what the sin that they've done and that they've committed, right? But sometimes we're not necessarily offended with the sin. We're offended and upset and angry towards the individual, towards the person. Amen. And so oftentimes hatred is covered up. It's covered up. It's covered up with a smile. It's covered up with, you know, okay, I'm going to talk about how we cover up hatred, because we're trying to unveil and reveal what is there, right? The walls, and bring those walls down and really uncover the bait of Satan and the strategies of Satan. Very quickly, I'm going to end with these scriptures tonight. 2 Samuel chapter 13, verse 22. 2 Samuel chapter 13, verse 22. And it says here in verse 22, "And Absalom spoke unto his brother Amnon, neither good nor bad. For Absalom hated Amnon because he had forced his sister Tamar." Okay, so we see that Absalom hated his brother. Amen. And as a result of him hating his brother, he spoke neither good nor bad. What individual or people that has offended you that you can't even speak good about them? And you can't even speak, you know, it's just like, I can't speak good or bad about this individual. Amen. Even if they've done good, right? But because hatred shows up and I can't speak any good about this person nor bad. Amen. That's hatred. That's one of the results of it. Let's look quickly at Genesis 37:4. Genesis 37:4. I hope y'all are getting this. I hope y'all are getting something from this, because I am. Genesis 37:4 says this. "And when his brother saw that their father loved him more than all of the other brothers, they hated him and could not speak peaceably unto him." Amen. So we see that Joseph and his brothers, right? Joseph's brothers hated him, right? Because the father favored Joseph. And as a result of the hatred, what showed up? They could not speak peaceably about him. Amen. See, a lot of this has to do with our tongue and our speaking. It doesn't always show up like this, hatred, you know, but it may show up in that conversation. It may show up in that mouth. Your mouth can tell, your lips can tell. That's why he said, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. So what is our conversation and our language about that person, about those people? Amen. 2 Samuel 13:15. Let's go back to 2 Samuel. 2 Samuel 13:15. And it says, "Then Amnon hated her exceedingly, so that the hatred wherewith he hated her was greater than the love that he had loved her." Amen. So Amnon hated Tamar, right? That he forced himself on. He hated her. And how we know he hated her, he avoided her. Y'all, I'm guilty. Feeling offense and saying, I'm just going to avoid them. Just gonna avoid. Am I the only one? Hey man, am I the only one? Right? So hatred shows up in avoiding. Y'all, it shows up in rejecting an individual, in rejecting a person, I just reject them, right? Or avoiding. If they're going to be there, I'm not going to be there. If they're going to show up, I'm not showing up, right? Hatred is not this all the time. It's I'm avoiding them because I don't want to have to deal with them. Amen. Ooh, this is so good. Proverbs 26 and 24. I hope y'all are seeing this tonight. Proverbs 26 and 24. A lot of this is coming from John Bervere's book, Bait of Satan. I want y'all to, if you're interested in furthering in this, check out that book, John Bervere, Bait of Satan. Amen. Proverbs 26 and 24. He that hateth dissembleth with his lips and layeth up deceit within him. Amen. So he that hates disguises it with their lips. All of this has to do with our lips. We can disguise it. We can say the right thing. We can disguise how we're really feeling, right? We can cover it up, right? With our lips. Amen? Wow. So we can even say to a person, I love you. But on the inside, I'm saying it, but I'm boiling. I have a wall, really. Amen. Let's look at this last scripture. 1 John 3:15. 1 John 3:15. This is so good. This is helping me. 1 John 3:15. And it says, whoever hateth his brother is a murderer. And ye know that no murderer has eternal life abiding in him. Hatred is deadly. He said, he that hates his brother is a murderer. So I just gave us some different faces of anger, and really all of them had to do with this piece right here. See, the spirit that leads to murder, whenever we carry offense, and this offense leads to betrayal, and this betrayal leads to hatred, it's a progression. We know that the spirit of murder is present. If you think about even the story of Cain and Abel, Cain was offended that his gift was not accepted by the Lord. And it led to his betrayal of his brother. And he had so much hatred that it led to the murder of his brother. That was physical. But I want us to see the big picture of the bait of Satan in this area of offense is that the seed is present. When we find ourselves in places, in situations, the offense is going to come. It's no getting around it. It's going to come. The seed is present. And if we don't deal with it, this fruit will grow progressively. Amen. So I want us to take some moments and some time this week before we meet again next week to really go through the scriptures, answer the questions that I presented to us. I'm going to answer the question. And I want to just say that I'm not offended with nobody, right? But then maybe there's somebody that Holy Spirit is bringing to my heart that I need to deal with. And I need to check my heart and check my life against the word of God and repent. Amen. So I want to pray with us tonight. Father God, I just thank you for this time, that the heaviness of this word, but the whew, the need of this word tonight. Father God, I thank you that this word has fallen on tender and receptive hearts, on hearts that can receive and hear and not grow offended by the word, but know that the word is only there to correct and to help and to challenge us and to break us into a place that is abundantly fruitful. So, Father God, I thank you that we are being honest with ourselves in areas where we may be feeling offended. And Father, help us to be able to avoid the baits of Satan, because what we learned in your word is that offenses are everywhere. Amen. It's impossible to go throughout life without feeling offense. That's why this word is so needed. But God, I thank you that you are bringing us to a place of understanding, recognizing, a place of healing, and in a place, Lord God, where we are always alert at the enemy's strategies against our life and against our relationships. May we be the type of believer that guards our heart and guards our mind and guards our lips in the name of Jesus. Father, I bless you for this time, and I give you the praise and the glory in Jesus Christ's name. Amen. Amen. My prayer is that you are blessed tonight, that you allow this word to really transform you. Amen. And even share the word with others that you may know who are walking through a fence. Sometimes the word may not be for us right now, but it may be for us to be a messenger and a carrier of this word with people who may be walking through a fence. Amen. Remember, we are all members called to be ministers. Amen. And so my prayer is that you all are blessed. If you're giving tonight, you can give via our Cash App. Our Cash App handle is ELOTW5415. You can give that way. Or if you would like to give on our website is www.elotw.com/give, and you can give in that way. Amen. God loves a cheerful giver, and we're so grateful for everyone who consistently sows and gives towards what we're doing at Emmanuel Light of the World. We're doing some great things. A few announcements and reminders for you guys. We have coming up in the month of November, on November the 18th, we will be hosting a community Thanksgiving. And so I'm so excited about it, because we've opened up this invitation to those that we serve in our community and their families. Amen. And we get an opportunity to serve them a wonderful catered Thanksgiving dinner and really just serve them. Amen. And so if you're interested in volunteering, please see me, let me know. I'll give you the information to be able to volunteer. If you just want to sit at the table and just eat, amen, that's also an option. Amen. And I'll give you that information to be able to register. Amen. We only have about 10 or 15 seats left. Slots are filling up really, really fast. And so we're super excited about what God has given us an opportunity to be able to do in our community. Also, on November the 11th, we're starting back with our Operation Snack Pack at West Clayton Elementary School. And so we're excited about that, an opportunity to be able to give some incredible snack packs to the homeless students there so that they will have food or snacks over the weekend until they get back into school. So on that following Monday. So we're serving them 30 students every Friday until the school year is out. So if you would like to give towards that, you can sponsor a child for $15 a month, or you can purchase a t-shirt, and 50% of the t-shirt money will go towards sponsoring a child. And or you can just purchase some of the items that we need to fill up the bag. So we need gallon size lunch bags or Ziploc bags. We need ramen noodles, fruit snacks, juice boxes, chips, all of those different types of snacks, grits, packages, applesauce. And so all of those, that information can be found on our website. So you can visit our website at www.elotw.com. And then you can see what we have left and what we need for you to donate. You guys be blessed. Have a blessed rest of your day or rest of your evening. And we'll see you guys same time, same place next Tuesday for Believers Night. Bye-bye.